Now that you have a basic idea of what rotational inertia is, I'm going to show you some examples that should set you up to be an expert in calculating rotational inertia. Let's start with this example. Imagine you have a massless stick of length L and you just attach two balls of clay to the ends of the stick. To keep things interesting, let's not assume the same mass for each blob of clay. Even though the mass is obviously not all located at one point, let's just assume that it is for this example. So those red dots represent the location of the mass of each of the balls of clay. Now, what's the rotational inertia of this configuration? Well, actually, that question does not even make sense until we choose an axis of rotation. So let's imagine that we're going to be rotating about the center of the stick. The rotational inertia is just going to be the sum of the rotational inertias of each of the blobs of clay. So for this configuration, the rotational inertia is m1 times l over 2 squared plus m2 times l over 2 squared. And simplifying a bit, we get that the rotational inertia is the quantity m1 plus m2 times l over 4. Now, what if I had chosen a different axis of rotation? Like, I can put the axis of rotation over here at the end of the stick. In that case, m1 is located right at the origin, and m2 is located at a distance l away from the axis of rotation. So in this case, the rotational inertia is m1 times 0 squared plus m2 times l squared. And I can rewrite that as m2 l squared. Okay, so you might be wondering, what happens if that stick has a mass? What's the rotational inertia of that thing? Well, you can always break an extended object into lots of tiny bits and use calculus to find the rotational inertia. And I have another video devoted to doing those types of calculations. But before we get into that, I'm going to skip to the punchline and give you a table with the rotational inertias of several common shapes. You'll find a similar table in almost any physics textbook. Here's the stick rotated about its central axis, and here's the stick rotated about its end. Now, you want to keep this table handy, and you should probably memorize the formulas for the hoop, the disc, and the rod, because these shapes come up so often. You'll also eventually want to learn how to derive the formulas for those same objects. The right-hand side of the table is interesting and useful, but you won't need to memorize those formulas. Now, notice that all of these formulas, with the exception of the one for the stick rotated about its end, are developed for an axis of rotation that passes through the center of mass of the object. But what if the thing is rotated about some other axis? Take the square plate as an example. What if instead of rotating about an axis that passes through its center, it's rotated about an axis that passes through one of its corners? In that case, there's a theorem called the parallel axis theorem that says that the rotational inertia about the other axis is equal to the rotational inertia about an axis through the center of mass plus mr squared, where r is the distance from the center of mass to the new axis of rotation. For this plate, we know that I about the center of mass is 1/6 ml squared, where L is the side length of the square. R in this case is half the length of the diagonal, which is root 2 over 2 times L. So making substitutions into the parallel axis theorem, I have 1/6 ml squared plus m times the quantity root 2 over 2 L all squared. Root 2 over 2 squared is just a half, and a sixth plus a half is 2/3. And so the final formula is very nice, 2/3 ml squared. The parallel axis theorem is super useful because once you have the rotational inertia about an axis passing through the center of mass, you can calculate the rotational inertia for any other axis of rotation parallel to that one. Of course, the parallel axis theorem only takes you so far. If you wanted to find the rotational inertia about this axis, the parallel axis theorem wouldn't do you any good. So just be careful not to overuse the parallel axis theorem. By the way, with a little thought, you can probably convince yourself that the rotational inertia for this last square is just the same as a stick rotated about its center, or 1/12 ml squared. Let's end with one last grand example. Let's say you run across a pendulum that's a combination of a stick with mass m and length l, and a square of mass big M and side length x, and you want to find the rotational inertia of this mess. All you need to do in this case is to find the rotational inertia of each of the parts and add. This is called the principle of superposition. You can go back to the table and find the rotational inertias of the stick and the square plate about their centers of mass. And since neither the stick nor the square is rotated about its center of mass, we'll have to apply the parallel axis theorem twice. Starting with the stick, the rotational inertia of the stick rotated about its center is 1/12 ml squared. And since it's rotated about one end, we need the parallel axis theorem. R in this case is L over 2, so I will add M times the quantity L over 2 squared. Now let's look at the square. The rotational inertia of a square rotated about an axis passing through its center of mass is 1/6 ml squared, where L is the side length. In this case, the side length is x, so I have to add 1/6 mx squared. But this square is rotated about an axis that's at a distance of L plus x over 2 away from the center of mass, so applying the parallel axis theorem, I'll add m times the quantity L plus x over 2 all squared. The first two terms combine to give 1/3 ml squared, and there isn't much to be done with the last two, so I'll leave them as is. I hope you found this video useful. If you understand these techniques, you should be in great shape to do some of your own calculations.